everybody. Thanks for joining us again. This is the final day of the Hearthstone Singapore Majors. I'm Patra, and joining me to cast is Lothar.
Hi, guys.
So we are located here at Bunk Hostel in Singapore, and we started out with 200 players around Southeast Asia. Some of them even flew in, and then yesterday we had 64 players. Now we're down to 16. Can you believe we're going to find the winner at the end of today?
Well, it's a long road for everyone. And they started already on Friday. We didn't see any matches on Friday because, you know, that was the almost 200 people playing at the same time in the winners and losers bracket, so it would be hard to follow. But we started yesterday with the 64 players remaining, with 32 winners bracket that you could just see. And look who made it to the round of 8 in the winner's bracket. So we have Winning Moon, Pew Pew Your Face. We switch to the other side of the winner's bracket. We have Handsome Guy, Reptile Tom, and Shiny Pants, who is here listed as the Shiny VP. And today, after the whole day, we'll have, of course, the winner. But it's still a lot of matches, and we'll see at least 7 today.
The crowd outside, they must be really excited to find out who their winner is.
Of course, it's. I mean, the crowd here is incredible. They're cheering. They're like always, you know, commentating what's happening. There's like 2 TVs outside with the crowd, and everyone is like, you know, just happy communicating with other people here and just making community. So it's really nice to see.
So let's throw it to TJ, who is downstairs with Waning Moon and Pew Pew.
Yeah.
Face.
See what he has to say.
Match, Waning Moon from the Philippines and Pew Pew from Singapore to get a few words before their match. So Pew Pew, I'm gonna come to you first, man. How are you feeling before this this match here?
I'm quite nervous because if I win this, I'll be in the top 8.
Are you confident though? You've been to a couple events now with Waning Moon. Are you confident that your lineup will match up well against his?
Yes, because I practice a lot on ladder.
All right, a big question here. Which country is better at Hearthstone, Singapore or the Philippines?
Singapore.
All righty, well, you heard it. Singapore is better. So we're going to head over here to Waning Moon, who's waiting on the other side. So, Waning Moon, I talked to you earlier. You said you were a bit nervous. Are you still feeling nervous going into this match?
Yeah, just the right amount of nervous.
Just the right amount of nervous. So you're feeling the pressure. You're the only player left from the Philippines. And we heard Pew Pew over there say that Singapore is better at Hearthstone. So are you feeling the pressure now? Are you going to bring it home for your fellow countrymen?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. He's confident. All right, well, good luck, guys. Good luck in your match. We're going to send it back over to the casters to get into the action.
And we're back. So before the match, we'll want to just show the crowd so you know how it feels like. In here, and you can see them cheering, and here we go. Woo!
Nice mingling in the crowd there.
Yeah, as we said before, it's a really nice atmosphere here in Singapore, although it's hot, really hot, especially for me. I'm coming from a cold country, so you know.
I'm used to it. I'm from the Philippines, so it's normal weather for me.
Yep. But next match will be, as we said, Waning Moon versus Pew Pew Your Face, and we can see the classes right here. So, Petra, what are the bans?
Okay, so Waning Moon banned the Warrior from Pew Pew Your Face, and Pew Pew has banned the Druid.
Yep.
That's pretty good bans from each side.
Just for the new viewers that didn't maybe see the matches yesterday, we are playing Conquest format with a ban system. So every class has to win at least one match if you want to win the whole, to win the whole match. So Waning Moon will have to win with Warrior, Paladin, and Warlock, while Pew Pew Your Face will have to win with Rogue, Paladin, and Druid. And basically that's it. It's a simple format.
Yeah. So we have Waning Moon from the Philippines, and actually Waning Moon has a team, Psystorm? And Pew Pew has from Singapore is with Mana Surge.
Yeah, he's a long-time player from Mana Surge, and I heard that Waning Moon is kind of like a life coach of the local community here. You know, he's like a cold analyst type of player that is kind of slow playing, but you know.
Yeah, he does take his time and he really thinks about every turn. He doesn't ever want to misplay. I mean, who wants to misplay?
Of course, especially if you're nervous. Like Pureface said, he's nervous before the match. We'll see if that will affect him. Hopefully not, but we'll see. And we're jumping into the game.
Ooh, there we go. We got the secret Pally with a sea giant. That's very different. And an Argent Squire.
Wow, for a second I thought that's a warlock.
And we have Pew Pew Your Face with the oil rogue.
Yeah, and a good opening hand. Deadly Poison and Path Shatter both are really great in the opening hand, just to know how you will handle the first initial turns. But the problem is for Pew Pew Your Face, is he aware of what he's actually playing against? Because, you know, it's not the normal, typical paladin mm-hmm. that you see, right?
I'm sure there has been word, maybe from other his past competitors, maybe they've seen the sea giant, and maybe Pew Pew already knows there is a sea giant. Maybe he doesn't know. Mm-hmm. But how do you feel about this matchup? Secret Pally versus Oil Rogue.
It depends on what Pew Pew Face will draw, of course, but he has already a Fan of Knights, which will be a really huge help against the huge amount of minions with Deathrattle from Winding Moon. Because if he wants to play the Sea Giant, that means he will have a lot of minions that have durable abilities, you know, and survive a lot. Exactly, to be honest. So a lot of minions that have death rattles with small minions like Hunted Creeper, and then the Fan of Knives of Preparation will be a huge help just to deal with those minions. Or an example, Backstab. So there's a lot of options. Just to clear the board before when you will be able to secure the board with a giant.
The Waning Moon has pretty much the perfect curve. He started out really well. We have, you know, Argent's Squire turn one, Creepers turn two, and possibly the Coghammer here if he wants on turn three.
I think it's it might be a mistake to play the Coghammer yet.
So you'd pick the Creepers over the Coghammer?
I think so, because you might want to play the Coghammer as with the best outcome as possible. So ideal would be to hit the Palter Shredder with it. But at the same time, if you hit the Divine Shield on the Argent Squire, basically it returns to the initial point when it was played, so it's not a bad outcome. And the Hunted Creeper with the Divine Shield will be great help against the Backstab Fan of Knives. So maybe actually Waning Moon will go for the Coghammer, and he goes for it.
Yeah, the Divine Shield and Taunt is like makes it more stickier and harder for the Rogue to get through.
It's still a problem though because he hit the Argent Squire, so it doesn't do anything against the Backstab and Fan of Knives. But fortunately for him, there's no Backstab and no Fan of Knives as a combo,
yeah.
And there's no Agent as well. So Pew Pew Your Face kept the initial Deadly Poison and Pile Shredder because he might have thought that this would be a different type of pattern and Deadly Poison will hold more value. So interesting development here. And for Waning Moon, it's also very important to know that he has the Divine Favor already in hand, because that will change the way of how he is playing. He might even overextend, although he's playing against a rogue that is capable of just, you know, sweeping the board with one or maybe two cards, but still he has the option to replenish his hand with the Divine Favor with a single card. We'll have to see what will be the development of this, but
I'm pretty sure the Shredder is going to be dropped, right?
Yeah, but I don't think there will be any trades made by Waning Moon.
Ooh, nice Shredder placement there by Waning Moon.
I'm sure Twitch chat is happy about that.
Yeah.
Everything goes to the face, so pressure put on Pew Pew, and he has to react. Wow, his hand is really slow. I guess this doesn't look pretty. Like, Fan of Knives here helps, as well as just daggering up. because you want to make space to...
He gets the heal.
Yeah. He just wanted to make the space for the Pulse Shredder attack. And that went through. For Waning Munde, this is an
This is tricky now, because yeah. now he's seen the fan of knives, and he thinks maybe his muster might be safe.
But the problem is he will kill his own masterful battle
oh,
with the pyromancer.
Oh, that's right! There's a pyromancer! So yes, he won't do that.
He might be... Now this kind of changes the line of play. He wants to sacrifice the pyromancer next turn, most mm-hmm. likely. Just because both of his cards in his hand are
spells.
So why would you keep that, right? And now Pew Pew will play the Azure Drake instead of the Low Death. Well, that's certainly interesting. He was looking for a preparation. A single preparation would be a really huge help here. But unfortunately for him, no backsteps, no preparations being drawn. So now Waning Munde has to sacrifice the Pyromancer just to play his hand. But Masterful Battle into Divine Favor is just crushing
huge,
here.
Yeah. He's going to get the
cards.
Biggest draw.
Seven cards for three mana. The value of this is like, wow, that's amazing. Let's just make the comparison to Arcane Intellect. Three
that's
mana for two cards, right?
That's really scary when a secret pally has a lot of cards.
I mean, I don't want to exaggerate, but this feels like GG already. You know, when someone draws, when someone plays an aggro deck and he has a three mana card that draws seven cards, yeah, it doesn't look pretty. Second Fan of Knives clears the board, but still, that doesn't hurt Waning Munde that much because he has the full hand. So, yep, this
and
is still
siege
a huge problem.
And the Sea Giant is there, but of course he can't play it yet.
Wow!
Oh,
mysterious
challenger.
So I didn't expect that, to be honest. You know, when I saw the Arden Squire.
Oh really?
Yeah, I mean, I thought this would be like the full-blown aggro paladin.
Oh no!
With just
no.
the Sea Giants in it. And it turns out it also packs the Mysterious Challenger. Interesting.
I'm very familiar with this deck. I have my own version of this, actually. I know that Waning Munde runs two Sea Giants. Mm-hmm. I only run one in mine.
So.
And I think he also runs the double Coghammer.
Double Coghammer is...
yeah, there's no true silver.
Common thing in every single paladin now because it just helps you
yes.
to have a board before you play the Mysterious Challenger, and it helps in the aggro version as well because it's just 6 damage for 3 mana and you know keeps you on the track with the minions surviving more turns so they deal more damage, but this is just horrible for Pew Pew.
Yes.
He doesn't have a sap.
Actually yeah, he doesn't have the sap, and I was actually thinking about that earlier. So how is he going to get rid of this mysterious challenger?
I don't see an easy way out of this. If you go Azure Drake, Blade Flurry, you just you just give him more attack. Because you kill the mini-bot. He gets redemption. Then he gets Avenge. The attack here might be actually a mistake. Because he puts more pressure on himself. He gets the additional damage from the Noble Sacrifice. He gets the Avenge proc'd and Redemption as well. So, this is actually a huge problem. The Avenge, luckily though, lands on the minibot. So that's a huge deal. If it would land on the Mysterious Challenger...
It would be hard to deal with.
Yep. Okay, so back to Waning Munde. He has 8 mana. Does he have an easy way of clearing the board for just to make one attack? Where's the Coghammer? So, Blessing of Kings on the Noble Sacrifice and Coghammer. You see the outcome. Then you can decide what order of attack you will do. So you'll go through the Sludge Belcher and deal the damage to your opponent. So it's maximum 7. Yeah, either
face,
way, it's
yeah.
7, because if you play the Blessing of Kings and Noble Sacrifice, both minions will have 7 attack. You will use the Coghammer to go through the second part of the Belcher. So it's just a matter of which one will get the Divine 7-7 or the 7-6.
Yeah, let's see which one. Yeah. I like that play.
And yeah, he uses the minion without the divine shield just because he didn't see the sap.
Did he run out of
time?
Yeah,
he did run out of time. He wasn't planning to play the Blessing of Kings at all. So he went with the knife dagger into mini bot, but unfortunately, he did miss his timer.
I mean, what he wanted to do. Was it the muster or the mini bot?
No, the mini bot, because he the mini bot has more survive. I mean,
more chances.
More chances to stick to the board, and he just played the cockhammer, so it would decrease the amount of damage by one next turn. Oh. But at the same time, that doesn't really change anything because Pew Pew was in such bad shape. That he had to concede here. But a slight misplay from Waning Moon.
Yeah, that was a really strong start and a really good game for Waning Moon.
Oh, definitely. I mean, perfect curve with turn 1, Argent Squire, turn 2, Hunted Creeper. Turn 3 was Masterful Battle, if I remember correctly.
I think it was Coghammer.
Coghammer, right. Coghammer, then Pile the Shredder into a... And then it was turn 5.
Divine Favor.
No, it was turn 6, actually. With Master Battle into Divine Favor because of the Pyromancer that was dropped from
right.
the Pyromancer. I mean, it was
turn
really
7, Mysterious Challenger.
Yes, it was a really an interesting match because the Pyromancer, although it was a very powerful drop from
it
the Pyromancer,
it's
a 3-2
from a Shredder.
Yeah, that's a very powerful stat being dropped from the Pyromancer. They kind of messed up a Waning Moon plan just to play the Masterful Battle in turn 5. But at the same time, who cares if you get 7 cards from Divine Favor.
Yeah, he's good. So,
Paladin is locked. We'll see no Paladin from Waning Moon. And now we have to pick either the Warrior or the Warlock. And we didn't see Waning Moon yesterday, so I have no clue what he's playing. But I would assume the Warrior will be a patron. Because it seems like...
Oh, yes. Nope. I'm pretty sure it's a patron. So I think we're going to be seeing the zoo. Waning Moon's Warlock, which is a zoo next. Oh, no. He's going with the patron.
Is he? Well, we'll have to see. I mean, from what I've seen yesterday, almost everyone here plays patron instead of control warrior. So it seems like it's more, you know, common in this area. And it is patron, actually. So.
Yeah.
And another Murloc Paladin, which was just a horrible deck yesterday. It didn't win a single game from what we have seen, and it was 6 times on stream. So it has a record so far on stream, 0-6.
Yeah, there really is a lot of Murloc Paladins now. Ever since, like, the winter prelims and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still kind of a new deck, and there's, like, all sorts of versions of it.
It is perceived as a new kind of new deck because you know it didn't have like that much of appearance before, and we know that Secret Paladin is like the most common Paladin ever played, apart from maybe the Aggro Paladin like a 1 year back, but still there are 2 main Paladins being played, as I said, Secret Paladin, Aggro Paladin, and the third one is actually the Murloc Paladin, which should be punishing control decks. But at the same time, it's not an easy deck to pilot. And Waning Moon, I'm sure that his experience against this type of Paladin, and he knows that he has to put a lot of pressure early game just to put the Paladin on the back foot. Good opening hand. Fear War X and Death Spite. Seems good.
Waning Moon is actually the last Filipino.
Is he?
Yep. Left in the tournament.
Well, he has to defend the honor of his area then.
And there's about 8 Singapore players left. So
yes, 8 Singapore players, so they have actually a really good showing here in the top 16.
Might be a Singapore winner.
Might be. Fury Warx has shut down the Acolyte of Pain, and the Taskmaster start doing, you know, some damage. It's good to put the Elder Pressure, but he will be shut down by the old Murkai next turn. Which is not a bad thing, you know. We want the old Murkai to be dead anyway, so why not put it down on the table on turn 4?
You really want to see your Murlocs come out early with a Murloc Pally.
So yesterday we saw a situation when a Murloc Paladin player actually played the anything can happen on turn 10 with no no Murlocs.
Yeah, like, I saw that.
Literally no Murlocs. We didn't see any reason to play it, but it was played, and it was like, I think an honest mistake by the player, and he was like, sure, that there were some Murlocs being played this game.
It's almost as if he was trying to show his opponent, like, look, I have two anything can happens in my hand. I can't do anything right now, so I'm just going to use it anyways and just show you.
So Wenning Moon didn't want to play Patrons next turn. This is why he didn't switch to the Death Spite this turn and attack with it. Maybe he would have changed his mind when he knew that he will draw another patron. In this situation, it's kind of clunky. You can't kill the Belcher with a single single attack, so it would have to sacrifice the pirate as well, and this doesn't look good.
Who do you think is favorable in this matchup? Would you say it's the Patron Warrior or the Murloc Pally?
Depends on the patron build. If the patron build is more mid-rangey, so it has Palter Shredders, it has, you know, Dr. Boom in it and the Grommash, then you can kill your opponent without even playing the patrons, because you can just burst them down, you know? Just deal the damage in consecutive turns with the weapons, with a single minion that builds up the pressure, and then you finish it off with the Grom on turn 8 with Inner Rage, which is a huge swing. But it all depends how the Paladin will respond to those threats. And it seems like PvPhase is actually doing a good job right now, because there's not enough pressure. Wow! He overrides Death Spite! That's a huge investment, a really huge investment. So he goes for the Battle Rage and kills the little slime with his pirate. That was actually a good turn, but the problem is he used one Death Spite and he doesn't have any kind of auto Waywind effects that
only
are accessible.
The ghoul.
Yeah, but it's not accessible the same turn as being played,
that's
right?
True. So
that's the problem.
And Pew Pew does have a Pyromancer and an Equality in his hand to clear the first batch of patrons.
And that has to be kept in the hand for the moment when Wenning Moon will overextend with the first wave. At the same time, he's at 28 HP, so nothing is pressuring him. The obvious choice for this turn seems like War Leader and Bloggle Warrior, because you put some pressure on the board and your opponent will have to respond with his weapon to kill the War Leader, and then you put War Leader and the Bloggle Warrior alongside the Murk Eye in the Anything Can Happen already. Doomsayer? No. Okay, so I thought that if he will go for the Hero Power and the Bloggle Warrior, because it was enough to kill the pirate, he will put the Doomsayer as well to avoid a turn 6 Emperor, an example, or just Dr. Beaumont with a coin. Which is happening right now.
You predicted it.
The Doomsayer in Paladin has like a slightly different approach than in the Freeze Mage, because you're not able to stall the game so much, right? You have no access to Blizzards, Frost Novas and spells like that. So the Doomsayer is mostly played like a preemptive attack.
That's right. So you must be maybe thinking about, maybe I should have dropped a Doomsayer last turn.
Yeah, because now it's a useless card, right?
Now he's kind of forced like to clear this. He doesn't have an Aldor Peacekeeper to lower the attack of the Dr. Boom.
Mm-hmm.
So can he really take that amount of damage to the face? He's going to have to.
That's a lackluster turn. Really lackluster. You give basically your opponent a chance to either overextend, which I believe Wenning Moon will not go for, because there's no reason to overextend when you have a 7-7 minion on board. You just leave that. Maybe you play the Corcoran Elite to deal additional 4 damage and to just armor up, and that's it.
That Boombot did 4 damage to the face.
That's actually a huge deal. That's half of the healbot, so seems like the healbot is not really a good option here. Now, Pew Pew's face is pushed to use the Equality to clear the board and play the Doomsayer as the preemptive attack, as we said before, but the problem is he's already on 9. We need Inner Rage to finish off the game?
With the Grommash.
That's not it.
Not yet.
Well, it's 1 mana short. I don't see any reason why we should play any minions right now, so just armor up. and basically does it. Do they prevent it? One wave of anything?
And the yeah. This was very expected. Pew Pew really wants to heal.
So he has one war leader, a Murkai, and a Bluegill warrior, and then anything can happen. And that is 4 attack from the Bluegill and 6 attack from the old Murkai. Ooh, doesn't enrage one card too late.
I know. You could see Waning Moon like tilt his head back, like, why didn't you come one round earlier?
I don't think you actually want to play it this turn. I mean, the enrage, you just save it for Grommash. So you just play Patron, Wyrmidon, and Unstable Ghoul, and that's it.
Yeah, I like that play.
Oh, he goes for the enrage. Wow, fully blown Patrons. Interesting, because that's kind of like, I don't care about Consecration as well. Well, if he doesn't play the ghoul, then it doesn't make a difference. We'll see if he plays the ghoul. No ghoul? No ghoul. Okay, so that's better than playing the ghoul. 5.
Oh, wow. That is the draw for Pew Pew.
Yeah, I just wanted to count the damage if he's like able to somehow survive this turn. Oh, that's you. Not this way.
That's weird.
Well, you have to use the Wild Pyromancer. I don't see an option. You have to use it. The problem is you don't have a way to clear the Grom. Let's see what's gonna happen. The anything can happen. Well, actually, it is 10 damage, so you have a way to clear the Grom. Oh. Ah, and this is why he should have kept the Inner Rage. Because now he's pushed to use it as a clear for the 1-1, and then it will die. Did anything can happen, and Pew Pew feels your face is perfectly happy with that. Perfectly happy, because now he will have second War Leader, second Murkai, and second Bluegill Warrior in his, you know, second anything can happen. So a huge amount of damage will be coming in Waning Moon's face next turn.
Yeah, it just swung around just like that.
Do you want to damage your face for 10? Is there a reason to? Well, you want to sacrifice the old Murkai and Bluegill Warrior anyway. And you would like to attack with the War Leader next turn so it will die. No, it doesn't make a difference if it will die or not, because you will still have the second one and anything can happen. So yeah.
Yep, he's gonna suicide both of them into the Grommash.
Still fine. So second War Leader puts a +2 attack on the Bluegill Warrior, so now it will be 6 attack from the single Bluegill Warrior, and the second Bluegill Warrior will deal another 6, so that's 12, and then you'll have 2 old Murkais with 5 different Murlocs each. So that's 11 attack on each of those. So you just go for anything can happen, and it's enough to kill him. Stack first with the War Leader. If you be... Oh, no, 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 it's a lethal. No, don't miss it. Don't miss the lethal. He's counting now. He's not sure. So he will have two Murkais and 2 Bluegill Warriors and 1 War Leader being spawned from the anything can happen. And that's +4 attack on each of the Bluegill Warriors, each of the Murkai. So that's 16 damage alone. And then you have the buffs from the old Murkai, which is +5 on each. And that's 26 Waning just from the buffs.
Waning Moon is relieved.
Well, unfortunately, Pew Pew Face somehow missed the damage, but he will still not die this turn.
Yeah, maybe he's saving it for next turn.
Well, he decreased the amount of damage. Only 1 patron remaining, but he has to play the anything can happen next turn anyway. And if that's not the shield block, it's not the shield block. So that's game anyway. But lethal was missed. Let's see your reaction from Waning Moon. Whoops! He had it all the way.
Oh, that is a lot of damage. Oh.
Well, and
extended
that's
BM.
Yep. Pew Pew equalizing the series 1-1 with his paladin. That's the first time we saw a Murloc paladin winning the entire broadcasted
first
part of this
time.
Yeah, I'm sure that it was winning off stream, but on stream, it's the first time we saw it actually win. But this was a very important win against the patron.
Yeah, that match was interesting. So, like, it seemed like Waning Moon had it earlier. Mm-hmm. And then...
I think he just overextended with the Inner Rage. He had the Unstable Goal in his hand, which was acting as a backup for the patrons. He had the Whirlwind, so he could have still made one additional patron, play the Ghoul, be kind of safe, and push enough pressure on Pupil Face to do something about the board. And then he would have still the access, still had the access to the Grommash. Let's see, maybe we'll have a replay of this situation. Here we go. Wow, it's actually backwards. Ha! So this is the turn when Patrons are being spawned and overextended with the Inner Rage, when there was still the Unstable Ghoul. So if the Unstable Ghoul had been played here instead of the Inner Rage, the Grom would have still been a threat, because now he has no access to, you know, just initiate the attack with the Grom. And that would mean 12 damage to the face, so 3 patrons or two patrons if the one with the buffed attack will just attack into the face. That would be enough to kill Pew Pew Face. So he was really in bad shape right now. Without the equality top deck, he was not able to finish up the initial wave. But that was the only way out of this game. And that's the only reason why PPFA's won, actually.
Mm.
So, thank you for the replay, guys. Nice production value. And I'm serious about it. That's a really cool feature to have.
So we might see the Patron Warrior again.
Probably.
Or a Zoo.
Well,
from Waning.
The two remaining decks for PPFA's are Rogue and Druid. Patron is not exactly the best against rogues, so I don't think you will actually want to stick to the rogue. Sorry, to the warrior, and he actually sticks to it. Like, there's a common thing about players. They tend to stick to the first deck that they lose with in Conquest format. So if you take that into account, you can kind of outplay your opponent. When we were checking with the team, like, the statistics of the players, and they usually do that.
Oh, wow.
So you can... You can predict that and take the best deck against the deck that just lost, and, you know, increase your chances.
Yep, so Waning did stick to the patron.
Yeah, and now we'll see the rogue, which has access to Blade Flurry, which has access to spell power, and, you know, two spell powers and Fend of Knives is actually enough to kill all the patrons as well. But of course, the easiest way to clear the board is Deadly Poison and Blade Flurry, or Oil and Blade Flurry.
There seems to be a lot of ways.
Yeah, and even a single spell power backstab kills a fresh patron, so it's also a help. You have the weapon, so you can clear the other patron with the weapon if it's buffed, so there's a lot of ways. And Pew Pew Face has a really good opening hand. 3 minions. Seems good. Corcoran Elite is unfortunately not an answer to the Violet Teacher, but the Violet Teacher itself is not really a big threat unless you want to push your opponent to use the Whirlwinds, the Ghouls early on with all the patrons, or the Death Spider tag, because, you know, sometimes your opponent will have to use the Death Spider with the one durability on the Violet Teacher just to clear the Violet Teacher and his apprentices. But at the same time, you didn't use your Death Spider without a Collide of Pain probably, or without the patrons. For Waning Moon, this is the time of analyzing the game plan and how do I want to finish the match with the initial 5 cards I have. And it means I will damage your face as soon as possible. But
Smork all
yeah,
the way.
But he didn't attack me. Interesting. Like, he has a very aggressive hand. 2 weapons, which is 3 weapons, wow. So now he has to attack, yeah. But so when you come to damage right now, and you know that the rogue probably won't have a single taunt, because you can assume that there's only like one Belcher, maybe 2, but there's a chance that we'll not get it. So the 2 Fear War Axes is 12 damage, a Death Spider is 8 damage, so that's 20 damage, but it requires 6 turns of attacks, right? But then you have the Corcoran Elite, which adds damage as well, and you have the Grom. So what you have to do is just pressure your opponent, So he will have to make a comeback. And that's basically it. The rogue is dead. He just doesn't have enough resources to sustain the situation.
So you think Waning Moon has to sort of just smork the rogue
down?
I think so.
I think it's a good way of playing this matchup. But at the same time, Violet Teacher is a threat when he doesn't have any kind of whirlwind effects in his hand. So it goes either a Corcoran Elite, just deal the damage, and say to your opponent, I'm bluffing that I have the clear, so he will play another minion and not overextend the spells. Because the second Violet Teacher now puts
Waning Moon
in a really awkward position. Now I have to play the Death Spider, attack to the face. Oh, he got the patron!
Nice! That is exactly what you want to see when you put out your Death Spider.
He attacked into the Violet Teacher as well, so his plan is to kill the next minion that will be played as well. So he's not into the aggressive way of playing this matchup. He's more into board control. But the problem is, the longer you play against Rogue, the better are the chances for the Rogue to actually draw his clear for the patrons and for whatever minion will be played. So the way of Waning Moon's playing this game is actually benefiting Pew Pew Your Face, because he had a horrendous hand to play against like a really aggressive matchup. Patrons being spawned. There is no Blade Flurry. But if he will draw it from the top of the deck, this will change the whole deck. Oh my god!
That is a drop.
Now this is a problem for Pew Pew Your Face. The lower could show. Whoops, that's me.
Like, Rogue has so many spells. Now he doesn't really want to play them?
Oh, you don't want to do that. He would love to play the Deadly Poison and kill one of the patrons, but then you give a Deadly Poison to a warrior.
That's just more damage to attack.
I mean, I can just say that if Deadly Poison was an accessible card for the warrior, the aggressive warrior with weapons and charge minions would have been an archetype by itself. Just by putting that one card to warrior's arsenal.
This is so tough for Pew Pew Your Face right now.
Backstab is being given to Waning Moon.
Yeah, he's forced to clear this board, but he's giving his opponent a bunch of spells.
Corcoran, another one. Wow, that's such an aggressive hand. If only Waning Moon was being more aggressive, Pew Pew Face would probably already be dead. So, Corcoran Elite. You don't want to kill the Cho.
You just
ignore it. So Corcoran Elite and maybe even Backstab, give it back, you don't care. Or do you care? Not sure.
Is he gonna backstab Fiery War Axe the Drake?
I think so. You don't want to lose your minions to Azure Drake, so it seems like you can just give the backstab back. Oh, he trades the Corcoran Elite, so he doesn't want to give the backstab back. But definitely agree. I definitely agree with the all smoke approach this turn.
More spells.
What do you do? Well, that's not a good option. I'm so happy that the Pilot's Shadow will not be instanted soon.
Yeah, it just changes the whole game, the Shredder sometimes.
Well, this is an awkward turn. Like, really awkward turn.
Yeah, what would Pew Pew do here?
That's a good outcome. You just lost. I mean, you can play spells.
Deadly Poison.
You can play Deadly Poison.
Argent. Agent.
Agent kills one of the patrons. Mm-hmm.
The Deadly Poison will kill the other.
But then you are at 10 HP, your opponent has one card. You had already one weapon, and you gave the dead poison, so that's half of your HP. You're on 5. And you know that your opponent is playing. Oh, wow, he gave the backs the Eviscerate. So that's the end of the game. Because giving out the Eviscerate is actually worse than giving the deadly poison. Because it's more damage.
Yep, by just one. For the face.
He saved
is that
three
lethal already?
Well, it's 4, 8, 11. No, in a rage. Oh, he can backstab his own Grom. What I'm talking about. Yeah. I just completely forgot that he has backstabbing.
Yeah, it's just weird to mix rogue cards with warrior cards.
He could have still pulled off a preparation and eviscerate on his own Grom to do the same as backstabbing it. So that was more than enough to kill his opponent. Slight BM from the Waning Moon here. I mean, it would look very differently. This match would actually look very differently if something else would pop from the Palter Shredder than the Low Walker Troll. Because that put Waning Moon in a spot when he was actually doing what he should be doing from the beginning of the game. So being the super aggressor in this matchup. And yeah.
The Cho just changed the whole game, really.
Yep, it did.
I wonder what it would have been without the Cho.
Well, then the difference would be the Cho would not limit the spells from the Rogue. So he was able to play Prep, Eviscerate, Sprint, maybe even to dig for more answers. And I think we'll have to actually have a chance to see that turn when Cho was being spawned and changed the whole dynamic of the match.
Yeah.
If the production team is ready, yeah, let's go.
So here's a replay.
That's a really cool feature. So this is the turn when the Low Walker Troll is being spawned. Inner rage on the patron to spawn more patrons. And look at the reactions of the players. There we go. Whoops. No, it landed. And now, this turn, if that will be a different minion, let's say the perfect scenario, free attack, it kills one of the patrons, the weapon kills the 5-1 patron, you have the prep, you have the backstab to kill another patron, so there's like tons of options. You can actually even ignore the 5-1 patron and just kill the other three. So you needed a 2-attack minion to kill the 3-2 patron, backstab to kill the 3-3, and the deadly poison to kill the 3-3, and then there's only one patron left. You're at healthy 24 HP, so even with the attack from the 5-1 to the phase, you're at 19, but probably we will just trade with the Azure Drake, and that's basically it. And the game looks completely different.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for the replay. And, yeah. Lower control.
So what's the score now? So it's...
The score now is Waning Moon wins 2-1 against PPFAZE, and he's only left with the Warlock. So PPFAZE has to pick either the Druid or the Rogue. He chooses the Druid, which in theory is the weaker matchup.
Yeah,
but as we know,
I would have picked the Rogue if I was PPFAZE against most likely a Zoo, right?
Well, you know, it's Conquest, so you have to win with every single class anyway.
That's
but
true.
Some people value the psychological effect of winning the game of your opponent and putting him in a situation when he's like, okay, I need to win this one.
Might as well do it already.
Yeah, so just a different type of approach. For Pew Pew, it's easier for him to just play with probably the harder matchup and just to, you know, do it already and be done with it. To put more hope into the last match for himself.
So we have a nice starting hand for Pew Pew Your Face.
It's fantastic. Living Druids put two small minions on your opponent and then the Wild Growth into Shadow of Nexramas. It doesn't really, you know, it's not a problem that you play a free drop when you have 4 mana because it's still a turn 3. And if you will draw a Palter Shredder, it's even better. So, it's a cool opening hand. I would have kept everything, for sure. For Waning Moon, wow, it's not bad either.
Both great starting hands, so let's see what happens.
Living Roots, of course, comes down on turn 1. With
the Living Roots can actually get through the Argent Squire, though.
So it's not a good play. Hunt Creeper is most likely to play because it's just, you know, plays around the Living Roots by itself. So it's great. Great stuff. 2 damage to the face. Wild Growth. Pass. Good to return. For Waning Moon, though, if it draws a PO, then he will probably want to play the Nurbanek, but he doesn't have it in hand already, so he goes for the safe play, which is Peddler, which will be allowed to trade with some minions. So we see the choices from the Discovery. Light Warden, Zombie Charm, Corruption.
What would you choose?
Ladies first.
You know, the corruption's pretty handy against big minions, but then I also like the Chao.
The Chao is just a huge body, and we know that Druid has problems with just doing anything about a big minion, and even though it's a one drop, it has 3 HP, so you have to like sacrifice a wrap on it, or you will have to sacrifice a really valuable attack from a huge minion like Druid of the Claw or Azure Drake. Wow, I'm definitely surprised by the fact that he innovated the Druid of the Claw here. Because that puts the Shadow Knight Summons in a really awkward spot. He values the 1-1 so much that he doesn't want to keep the innovate to play a 7 drop, an example, next turn if you will draw one, right? Because you're naturally curving out with a Druid of the Claw and Azure Drake next turn. Well, naturally, he had a Wild Growth. Never mind. That he values this more than the 1-1. I'm
Would
really
you
surprised.
Have put the Nax instead of
yeah.
that?
Shadow Nax Shamus, just attack the face for 1. It's more than enough. Or just attack into the Hunter's Creeper and say to your opponent, I have a swipe in my hand, so you can't play anything, basically, that overextends. So now Shadow Nax Shamus and Wrath. I mean, this is a pretty lucky draw, because now we can cure about. The chances of drawing the Wrath were not that high, and other cards that will be benefiting the Shadow Nax Shamus play this turn, well, actually the other Living Roots, which puts you on 4 mana usage, or is there anything else? I don't think he plays the Darnassus Aspirant, so now it's either Azure Drake or just Shade and Wrath. Wow, aggressive.
I probably would have cleared board.
I mean, I like the aggressive approach. The problem is, you can't really benefit from this situation. Like, if your opponent has a PO, you're still in a bad spot. And he sacrifices the 1-1 here anyway, so if you can, like, the draw from the Wrath actually changed his way of planning this turn. As he was valuing the 1-1 less turn so much to not trade the Hunter Creeper, but he did it himself this turn.
Yeah, it's I noticed that too.
Oh, F4! That's how we play Zoo.
And there's no swipe for Pew Pew.
That's Living Roots, which is dealing 3 damage, but it doesn't actually do much. Force of Nature. Damage
killed
to the face?
Peddler.
I mean, you have Force of Nature, you can draw a Savage Roar and then Innervate.
That's true.
And if you deal 3 damage here, then you have a Shadow Knight Summons with 4 attack next turn. So it has 5 attack on the turn when you can play combo with Innervate, if you're lucky enough to top deck Savage Roar into Innervate. So you have 19. So we'll actually kill him, because you will use Hero Power in the meantime. But that's like a far-fetched plan. Like a really far-fetched plan.
Yeah, this is exactly what TJ and I were talking about yesterday. Sometimes you gotta know whether you want to smork or trade into the border or clear the board.
I mean, PPU's game plan was inconsistent from the beginning, so I have no idea what he will prefer here. He prefers the 1-1s.
So they're just gonna die anyways.
Which is basically like, well, I will kill your peddler. So, interesting. Sacrifice the egg. You know that there's no swipe, because the swipe would have been already played.
That's
so
right.
You can pop the egg this turn. So let's say that there will be Direwolf Alpha between the egg and the imp. The egg attacks into the Azure Drake. Then 2 other imps are killing the Azure Drake. Then you have a keeper, sorry, peddler that kills one of the 1-1s. And you sacrifice one of the imps because you are worried about double Savage Roar? Yeah, I think so. So you just leave the Shadow of Nax Shamus here. Oh, he doesn't pop the egg. Interesting. Peddler. There's no swipe. Use the peddler. Oh. Well. Okay.
Yeah, I would have liked to see the egg being broken there, too.
That would be really, like, you know, a risky play, because you play around no swipe, but there was no swipe. So there are only 2 chances to draw the swipe next turn, and there's, like, I guess around 19 cards left, if I'm mistaken. second
another
force of nature.
He's gonna have to use one right now and start clearing the board.
Oh, let's see. What if he just ignores the board and the situation for one turn, and then he will see his next draw, so he can plan if he can actually finish the game on turn 9.
So now this turn makes, like, he really should have popped the egg last turn. It would have been better for waiting one, because now his egg is kind of just sitting there again.
Yeah, well, he was playing around the swipe, but as I said, it didn't kind of made sense when you know that your opponent doesn't have a swipe. And there's only two chances from 19 to draw it from the top of the deck. And you still have a full hand to replenish the board, even after a swipe.
Do you think Waning Moon's going to tap here and Peddler, or he's just going to go for the Doom Guard?
I think you play Peddler first to see what's your discovery. P.O. Okay, that's not bad. Will he use it already? You have the... I would like to use it right now. Yes, you have 2 mana left. You have the Owl if a Belcher will be played next turn, or a Druid with the Claw. So you will discard only one card from your hand after you play the Doomguard next turn. Tournament attendee, why not? Play it. It's a Taunt minion.
Yeah, I like the Taunt. So Taunts are always good against Druid.
Yeah, Taunt, PO, attack with the egg, 4 damage, spawn 4/4. Next turn, you can silence any kind of taunt and just attack with the face with the Doomguard and the rest of the field. Let's see if that's the plan for Waning Moon. Yep, I like that. Being mana efficient and aggressive at the same time. Bloop. 4/4 appears. Keeper. Well, that's one turn too late. If he sacrifices the Force of Nature, it will be very, very bleak looking for PPFace to close this game. Because now he has to think, how do I actually win? I'm running out of cards, I don't have an Ancient of Law, the Keeper of the Grove is actually helping here, because it can kill the 2/2, I can use the hero power to kill the 2/1, and I have 5 attack minion on board. So if it grows to 6, and I will draw Savage Roar, that's 8. So that's 22 with combo, if your opponent doesn't have a Defender of Argus. And I'm sure that the Defender of Argus would have been already played this turn.
If he had one.
So you are banking on the topic of Savage Roar.
That's right.
Just next turn to win the game. No! Don't use the Force of Nature! No! And that's how you lose the game.
If he top decks Savage Roar next turn.
Goes even with the attack from the Shredder Nexramas, so now it's exposed to Doomguard. And it can even be killed by just.
It can be silenced.
Yeah, it can be silenced, just ignored. Whoopsie. The Doomguard's
still
being played.
So his winning chances are very low now.
Yeah. Actually, there's no way he can win. Unless he draws Ancient of Law next turn. Then maybe there's a chance. Now, you don't want to sacrifice these small ones. You just deal 2 damage in the face. 5 damage in the face. You just ignore the 2/2. It's useless. There's 2 Force of Nature already being used. They wouldn't be used if there's a Savage Roar in hand. So you're sure that the card in the hand for PPF is not a Savage Roar. Mm-hmm. So you don't care about the 2/2. You just lost 5 damage. Ref. Well, that's not helpful. I mean, you can kill the Doomguard. But the problem is, your opponent will have more card draw.
Oh, he does. He really wants an extra card.
Yeah, the problem is...
You can't play both of these.
You're playing a Druid, and you're leaving 7 mana, so unless the top deck is Dr. Boom, it's not really beneficial, because if you plan to play the Keeper of the Grove, you're left with 3 mana, and the only 3 mana cards that are left in the deck are Savage Roars, which is not helpful here, is another Wrath, and... Another Shade of Nexramas. So the draw from the Wrath was actually less important than the damage dealt to the Doomguard. And then this Defender of Argus just to, you know,
to make things even make things even harder. See, all these little little things matter in Hearthstone. Those little tiny plays.
I mean, the most important lesson for every single player that he has to, at some point, reach the conclusion himself as well, is what did I do to not win? Mm-hmm. Not what did I do to not lose. It's just what did I win to not win? Because that's the most important question. Sometimes you put a less efficient play on the board just because it set up a way of winning the game instead of just, you know, being safe and just clearing the board because your opponent is just, you know, just on the back foot. If your opponent is on the back foot, you probably want to emphasize on your attacks because that puts just so much pressure on your opponent.
Waiting Moon is deciding whether to face or...
Good.
There he goes, face! I'm sure Twitch chat loves the smork.
I mean, Hearthstone's a game of really being an aggressive player. Because of the fact that Hearthstone doesn't have an interaction during your opponent's turn, being aggressive puts your opponent in a position when he has to use his own resources during his own turn to make a comeback. And if he doesn't have an answer to the aggressiveness from player A, then the player B loses.
Makes sense.
Especially that's especially visible in decks like Druid. Pile Shredder? Yeah, why not? I mean, Pile Shredder, kill the 2/2. There's not a lot of options. You can't really kill the Doomguard, so you're dead. Basically, yeah. And that's it. Honorable Sudoku.
I was just about to say that. Well, those were some interesting games.
3-1 for Waning Moon. He advances to the next stage of the winner's bracket.
Congratulations,
so now he's at least in the top 8, if I'm not mistaken. Loser's bracket from... Wait, it's winner's bracket top 16. Now... Pew Pew Face is being knocked down to the loser's bracket, mm-hmm. So his role is extended, because he still has a chance, but he has to win more games. And Waning Moon is on a winning streak, because...
Yeah, he's never been in the loser's bracket. He's still in the winner's bracket.
So he will get to know his opponent after a few more matches, but for now, he's calm. He's just waiting. So, as you can see, he put the winning streak with his Warrior, Paladin, and Warlock, while PvPFace was able to win with the Murloc Paladin. That's something.
Yeah, that was the first. So, up next, we're going to have the top 8 lower bracket.
Okay, so we'll have a small break. So, don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be back with some more Hearthstone action as soon as possible. This is the Hearthstone Southeast.